and his wife Michelle have flown out from Calvary Chapel Thousand Oaks to bless us two Sundays to bring us the word this morning. And I hope you'll meet and greet them after the service if you haven't already. But would you give Rob McCoy a welcome back to Kumulani Chapel?
Thanks, bro. All right. Well, I've spoken at Kumulani Chapel once before, and a number of folks came up and said, "You're really funny. Are you going to be funny this time?" No. But next week I will be. This message this morning, it's an interesting one that kind of came together. This is my devotional book. It's a one-year Bible. And on September 11th of this year, it fell on a number of scriptures, but one in particular was Isaiah 9. And I thought how fitting it was as I started to take a look at Isaiah 9. And all of a sudden, I'd been reading a couple books, and this message kind of came together, and I was touched by it. But this morning, we're going to begin the message, and it's titled, "What is Truth?" And we're going to begin, if you would turn with me, to John chapter 18. John chapter 18. Now, I'm going to ask, just to make me feel a little bit more comfortable, at Calvary Chapel Thousand Oaks, I like to distinguish between two very important facts. And the way I do that is, and don't do it right now, we'll do it in a moment, but the way I do it is I have you stand for the reading of the Word of the Lord. And here are the two facts I like to distinguish. When we stand for the Word of the Lord, we distinguish between the Word of the Lord and the Word of the teacher. One we honor, and the other we tolerate. So we're in John chapter 18, and would you please stand for the reading of the Word of the Lord? I'm going to pick up in our reading in verse, no, I don't know, what do you want to pick up at? I've lost my place. What is it? Oh, here it is. Yeah, thank you, 28. All right, thank you. You want to read? You can, no, okay, verse 28. 38. No, I don't want to go there yet. Now you're pushing it. Verse 28. Here we go. That's right. But now we're going to honor. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium, and it was early morning. But they themselves did not go into the praetorium, lest they should be defiled, that they might eat the Passover. Pilate then went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" Speaking of Jesus. They answered and said to him, "If he were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him up to you." And then Pilate said to them, "You take him and judge him according to your law." Therefore the Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death, that the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spoke, signifying by what death he would die." He was to be crucified. And that had been prophesied 700 years before crucifixion had ever been invented, interestingly enough. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again, called Jesus, and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking for yourself on this, or did others tell you this about me?" And Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done?" And Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here." Pilate therefore said to him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus answered, "You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I might bear witness to the truth, to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." And Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" Now, I don't know how he asked that question. I mean, there's different ways to ask it, isn't there? What is truth? Or what is truth? We don't know how he asked the question. And when he had said this, he went out again and said to the Jews, "I find no fault in him at all." And then I'm going to read real quickly out of John 14. And Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." Pilate was standing in front of the embodiment of truth, and he asked, "What is truth?" And he was looking truth straight in the face. We're going to take a look at that passage, but let's pray and ask God's blessing. Lord, we do ask your blessing on the study of your word. And as we undertake this study, I pray that you'd minister to every heart. Lord, we're in an interesting season, a political season, where everyone is calling the other a liar. Everyone declares that their figures are true. And yet, Lord, we're here in this place, holding open your word, which is living and breathing and sharper than any two-edged sword. It's able to divide the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And you command us, as it says in 2 Timothy 2:15, to study, to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen who need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So, Lord, you are true. You are the word. And we're here today to receive from you. In a season where everything is declared to be a lie, we are in the presence of the truth, and we rejoice. We thank you, God. Your word is true. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Have a seat. Relax. I'll sweat for you. I am moved as we've been undertaking a study back home in Ephesians chapter 6, and we've been looking at the armor of God. And it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, and put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the wiles of the devil. For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And then it goes on to say, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. And then it says, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth. And as the Apostle Paul was writing this letter to the church at Ephesus, he was looking, as he was chained to a Roman centurion, he was looking at the armor of this Roman centurion, and he's going, now, you know, tell me what the helmet means again, and what is the breastplate, and how does that work, and that belt there that holds the sword, how does that work? And it's almost like, you know, people would say that Paul was a prisoner of Rome, but it was the other way around. Rome was a prisoner of Paul. You can imagine the centurion going, again, Paul, jeepers, this is ridiculous. He goes, no, it's a perfect application to this church in Ephesus that I'm writing to, and I'm imprisoned in Rome, but I got to write this letter to him about spiritual armor. That's okay. Just tell him, you'll call him back. And so at this moment, he's looking at all of these armaments on this centurion, and the first thing he begins with when he's talking to the church is he says this belt of truth. This belt of truth. He goes on to talk about the breastplate of righteousness, but he begins with the belt of truth. This is the center theme of the Roman soldier. It's the center theme of the Roman soldier. And it holds every portion of his armament together, and it equips for the sword and everything about him, and it protects him completely in that respect. But it's the center theme. It's the center of gravity for the Roman soldier. And that's what Paul's saying. He says, we begin this entire battle against evil with the understanding of truth. Now, this is a tough one, truth. Because we live in a culture nowadays, especially in America, where we have been subjected to relativism, where truth is subjective. Truth is no longer absolute. One of the greatest struggles we have in our culture today is this idea that there's no such thing as a moral absolute. We have no desire to embrace this concept of absolutes, and we don't want to because we don't want to be offensive. The greatest virtue in America today is not truth. The greatest virtue in America today is tolerance. Tolerance is the greatest virtue in America today, in that our desire is not to want to offend. How dare you make a stand and make a statement that would be in opposition to what I believe? That's intolerant. But I have to declare, especially this morning, that the truth is never tolerant of a lie. There are absolutes that govern the universe, and there are spiritual absolutes that govern the human soul. 2 + 2 is 5. You got it. That's great. Let's try that again. 2 + 2 is
4.
But wait a minute. Wait a minute. That's a little narrow. I mean, why does it just have to be one answer? I really feel like it should be 3. I really feel like it should be 3. And a lot of people agree with me it should be 3. You're going, yeah, but it's 4. No, that's your opinion. Yeah, you go ahead and write it down. You get an F. But what happens in subjective, looking at truth as subjective as opposed to looking at absolutes, what happens is it's this relativism that you get to make whatever truth you want. And if you stand for everything, you stand for nothing. And there's no foundation. You see, the reason why the Apostle Paul begins in our walk as Christians with the truth, and it's the belt plate, it's the center of everything that we are. It's the belt, it's the center of everything we are, that if we don't have a firm foundation, everything crumbles. You have to have a foundation on which to build. Any builder knows that. Any contractor knows that. You have to remove all the rubble, get down to the bedrock, and pour the foundation. As strong as the foundation is, will be how strong the structure is going to be. You have a lousy foundation, you have a lousy structure, period. And the foundation must be this understanding of truth, and that's why Jesus said, I am the truth. He didn't say, I am a truth. He said, I am the truth. He didn't say, I am a truth. He made it very exclusive. He made it very narrow. People say, well, that's so narrow. Truth is narrow. In a world of absolutes, there's only one. Well, I don't believe in absolutes. I would ask you this question, and think about it. I know it's somewhat early. You don't believe in absolutes? Here's a question for you. Do you believe that absolutely? I guess that doesn't work. You see this, the lunacy in it? There are no absolutes. And I believe that absolutely. There are absolutes. There's a law of gravity. Yeah, but I don't believe in it. I'm going to chant a mantra. You won't die. You'll fly. You won't die. You'll fly. And I'll meditate on flying. And then I'll just run off a cliff after a long time of meditation. Truth doesn't care whether you believe it or you don't believe it. It's always there. And it is narrow. We have inculcated our culture to make truth subjective as though we're allowed to make it up as we go. You don't do that. You don't have a foundation upon which to stand. Jesus said, I am the truth. It was C.S. Lewis who said, based on Jesus' statement in John 14, it was C.S. Lewis, the theologian and the great author who wrote all the tales of Narnia. He's the one who said, it's called the trilemma. You can't say that Jesus is a good man and get away with it. He's either one of three things. Based on what he said of himself, he's one of three things. He's either a liar, because he says he's the way, the truth, and the life, and he isn't, and he knows it, and he's lying. Or he's a lunatic, and he belongs in Happydale, because he believes himself to be the way, the truth, and the life. And he believes it, but he isn't. So he's insane. Or he's God. And he is the way, and he is the truth, and he is the life. And no man comes to the Father but by him. Narrow. And you say, oh, Pastor, that's so narrow. That's truth. There's one answer. And there's absolutes that govern the universe. And there's a God who governs the universe, who holds the heavens in the span of his hand, and a sparrow doesn't fall from the sky without his full knowledge. He has every tear you've ever cried in a bottle. He has the hairs on your head numbered. And he runs it all. And he knows it all. And he says to you this day, I am the truth. Come to me, all you are burdened and heavy laden. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You will build on a firm foundation. Even the Beatitudes, Jesus' sermon to his disciples said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. That's the foundation upon which you pour. When you realize, I bring to the equation nothing, and God, I come to you for everything. You're the truth. You're the foundation. Help me, God. And anyone who's honest with God, he will always be merciful with them, always. And so here's Pilate looking Jesus straight in the face, seeing what the Jews have done to bring him to trial and unwilling to crucify him, unwilling to kill him because they wanted to enjoy the Passover meal and this outward expression of religiosity, although they were whitewashed sepulchers on the inside. They were dead as dead men's bones. And as Pilate looks at him, he says, are you a king? He says, you say rightly, I am a king. My kingdom is not of this world. And he said, I am the truth. He declares that. But Pilate's declaration to Jesus is, what is truth? Now, the Bible says, if you seek me, you will find me, if you seek me with all your heart. See, it's not that the Bible has been tested and found wanting. It hasn't been tested at all. People come to a conclusion about Jesus Christ based on a comparative religion class they had in some community college or some zeitgeist video they saw on the internet. Are you kidding me? It's somebody else's regurgitated mess that you are ingesting, and you're basing your eternity on somebody who was angry with God earlier in their life and came up with some ridiculous foundation that isn't one at all. And we bounce through life in a merry way, thinking as though we're all good, but it'll be appointed once for a man to die. Then judgment will stand before God and give an accounting of our life, and we'll look the truth straight in the face. All things will be made known. The sun rises and the sun sets. You say, well, I've never seen God. I don't believe in him. I've never seen the builder of this shed, but I know he exists. There's order and design. Not great, but there's order and design. I probably insulted the person in the room. Forgive me, brother or sister. But the idea is, I know you exist because there's order. You look at the universe, there's order to it. Four seasons. Sun rises, sun sets. We're 93 million miles away from the sun in such a delicate balance that if we were to move 5% closer to the sun, we would burn. If we were to move 5% further away, we'd freeze to death. And this delicate balance being held in the universe on nothing. And even the psalmist declares the sphere of the earth long before the Western world even declared the world to be round. The Bible said it. And you dismiss it? 66 books of the Bible written by over 40 authors on three different continents over a span of 10,000 years and cover to cover doesn't contradict itself once, and it speaks beyond the space-time continuum by the more sure word of prophecy, as it says in Peter. There's over 300 prophecies pertaining to Christ alone that were fulfilled. He'd be born of a virgin, born in Bethlehem. Anyone in the room born in Bethlehem? No! Maybe in the span of the universe, it might be a million people, maybe. He'd be betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. He'd be crucified. 800 years it was prophesied before crucifixion had ever been invented. If you were to take seven of those over 300 prophecies, it would be the equivalent statistically of covering the entire state of Texas 3 feet deep in silver dollars, painting one red, throwing it somewhere between Austin and El Paso, and parachuting a blind man in and have him wander the state of Texas, reach down, dig through the 3 feet, pick one up, and it's painted red. That's for seven, and there's over 300, and you're telling me that this is dismissible? No. You are wrong. Do your homework. The truth is staring you in the face. Regardless of your position or your power or who you think yourself to be, God is holding your heartbeat right now. He's come that you might have life and life more abundant. And all the beauties and the intricacies of life, and especially on the islands, we tend to forget that it's a God who loves us and has called us to the truth, that the truth would set us free. Now, I say all this because as we look at these declarations of Jesus, it was Alan Bloom, actually an agnostic Jewish secular philosopher, and he wrote a book called The Closing of the American Mind. And his greatest frustration in The Closing of the American Mind, as he wrote it, and he wasn't a Christian by any stretch of the imagination, but he said the sadness is that students who have been raised up in the public school systems of the United States of America and have been subjected to subjective truth or relativism now get to the university and they're astonished to think that anyone would stand on a moral absolute. Who are you? And he says this is the closing of the American mind because no longer do we have the Socratic approach or the Platonic approach to look at truth and to distinguish it and to reason together. We operate in this insanity. You go and you interview students, and the ones that came up here going on college tours, you've got to have that foundation. You are going to be obliterated without it. You're going to be influenced by so many things. And here's the one part that blows my mind. They did a survey on college campuses to say, was the Holocaust immoral? Over 6 million Jews incinerated. Was what Hitler did morally wrong? Well, I didn't necessarily agree with what he did. I personally think it wasn't good, but I don't know his background. I don't necessarily know kind of his upbringing. Six million people were incinerated. I know. But what? Peter Singer, who was in charge of ethics, a bioethicist at Princeton. This is the university that was founded by Jonathan Edwards during the Great Awakening in America to train ministers. Peter Singer is now over the Department of Ethics. And his approach? It's morally okay. It's morally okay if a parent wants to kill one child to harvest the organs for the child they care about more. Sex with 20 or 200 is acceptable. Utilitarianism. He says, the issue isn't about killing a human child in abortion. It's that the child isn't human to begin with. It's a blob of tissue that can be harvested for needs of utilitarianism for those who need that. I mean, if you're sitting at the kitchen sink and you're washing dishes and your child comes up behind you and says, Daddy, can I kill this? The first question is, hello? What is it? It's a cockroach. Step on it. It's my little brother. Hang on, let me get one. Help me out. But it's not a baby. Isaiah says before, Jeremiah and Isaiah, before you were born, I knew you. You've been fearfully and wonderfully made, knitted together in your mother's womb. If it's not a human being, what is it? It can't be anything else. Yes, but the size is too small, so it doesn't qualify for adulthood. It doesn't qualify for humanity. Oh, I see. So you're telling me the size is what makes it legitimate. So you're telling me a taller person or a larger person is more valuable than a shorter person, so we should kill short people too? No. Amen. Bless you, Steve. I see your hand. All right. Well, it's the level of development. It's not fully developed. Okay. Level of development. So you're telling me that a child that hasn't reached full adolescence is less valuable than a fully grown adult because they haven't matured in a level of development? So we're allowed to kill children? No. Anyone agree with that? Well, it's its environment. It's in the mother's womb. She has the full rights. Environment. So you're probably going to struggle with this illustration, but you're telling me that I am more valuable behind this pulpit in Hawaii than I was in the pulpit in Thousand Oaks? Some of you are going, yes, it's Hawaii. The answer is no, I'm still me. Happier, but I'm still me. Environment has nothing to do with it. How about this? It's the degree of dependence. It's dependent on its mother. That's why it's not fully human. Degree of dependence. Oh, so you're telling me that the people in the room who are diabetics who are dependent on insulin are less valuable than you, and we should kill them? This is called the search for truth. It was our founding fathers in the Declaration of Independence that said, we hold these truths to be self-evident. That's a Jeffersonian way of saying any idiot can understand this. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal with certain inalienable rights endowed by their creator, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, I share this with you because we are in a dilemma. It was Winston Churchill who said, all politics in Europe are based on the sole purpose of obtaining power. In America, it's the pursuit of truth. But he said this in the 60s, just a few short months before he died. He said, but I fear that in America it is now turning towards an attempt to obtain power, and truth is no longer desired. You see, up until the 1930s, for over, 150 years in America, our students were educated with one textbook. One textbook. Wouldn't that be great? We'd save all kinds of money. They didn't have no chiropractors with a big backpack. And the book, I kid you not, the book was this high, this wide, and that thick.
Oh, what could you teach him with that? That's ridiculous.
Quite a bit. It was called the New England Primer. It was an acrostic. It began with the alphabet. A is for Adam and the fall of man. C is for Christ. E is for Eve. Instilling in the children a foundation of the truth of the scriptures of God's word that would see us through the first, second, and third great awakening with the greatest expanse of a nation in the history of the world. No one has ever obtained. We have more patents. We represent less than 3% of the population of the world. We have more patents, more copyrights, more accomplishments than any other nation in the history of the world. But it was in the 30s that John Dewey came along and wanted to assess relativism and subjectivism and remove the scriptures. So we remove the Bible. We think, well, what's wrong with that? We're open-minded. You need to be open-minded. Is that like being open-mouthed? What do you mean by that? Well, okay. Are you going to ingest cyanide because you need to be open-mouthed? Well, no, cyanide will kill me. Well, so will some thoughts. Unless you have the ability to process them. And so as we come to this place and we look at it, Alan Bloom and Peter Singer and what has happened to our nation. I say this because there are two nations on the face of the earth, two nations on the face of the earth, two nations on the face of the earth that have consecrated themselves to God. Two. In their birth certificates, their founding of their nations. One is Israel and the other is the United States of America. Some of you go, oh, I don't buy it, Pastor. I'm a history major. Let's contend after the service. Serious. I'd love to. And I don't say that braggingly. I'd love to discuss with you. When Solomon dedicated the temple after David had expanded the boundaries of Israel far beyond anything they'd ever seen before, he dedicated the temple and the Shekinah glory of God filled the temple so thick the priests couldn't enter it. But remember this, the ground of a nation's consecration is going to be the ground of its judgment. I'll repeat that. The ground of a nation's consecration will become the ground of its judgment. The ground of a nation's consecration will become the ground of its judgment. The nation of Israel was consecrated to truth. It was consecrated to God. It was consecrated to this idea of the pursuit and the declaration of truth upon the land, that God is true, that his Messiah will come, that the world will be blessed through him, that you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free, and that we are preparing and to make straight the way of the Lord. And that nation would veer away from those absolutes, and God would say, you do this, I'll bless you. You do this, and you're going to be in trouble. You'll enjoy vineyards you didn't plant and cisterns you didn't dig, and you will have an abundance, and you will be a lender. You don't obey me, your cisterns will leak, your vineyards will rot, and you will be indebted. The Bible says righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. God judges nations, especially those that consecrate themselves to God. And you say, well, wait a minute. I can buy the idea that Israel was consecrated to God, but how are you pulling it off with America? April 30th, 1789? April 30th, 1789? Very first inauguration of the very first president of the United States of America, George Washington. At the Federal House. Read his first inaugural address, and you tell me that's not consecration. I have a portion of it here, and it's a pretty amazing. It says, such being the impressions under which I have in obedience to the public summons repaired to the present station, it would be peculiarly improper to omit in the first official act my fervent supplications to Almighty God, who rules over the universe, who presides in the councils of the nations, and whose providential aid can supply every human defect, that his benediction may consecrate to the liberties and happiness of the people of the United States a government instituted by themselves for these essential purposes, and may enable every instrument employed in its administration to execute with success the functions allotted to my charge. In tendering this homage to the great author of every public and private good, I assure myself that it expresses your sentiments not less than my own, nor those of my fellow citizens at large, less than either. No people can be bound to acknowledge and adore the invisible hand of God, which conducts the affairs of men more than the people of the United States of America. And then he says, we ought to be no less persuaded that the propitious smiles, which means the kind smiles of heaven, can never be expected on a nation that disregards eternal truths and rules of order and right which heaven itself has ordained. And since the preservation of sacred fire of liberty and the destiny of the republican model of government are justly considered as deeply, perhaps finally, we staked of that experiment, he says, we need to pursue truth. And we consecrate this nation upon the God of all truth. He said that at the federal building, walked a few short blocks with the vice president, both houses, both the Senate, both chambers of the House, both the Senate and the Congress, the House and the Senate, excuse me, all the judges from the Supreme Court, and they marched a few short blocks to this place called St. Paul's Chapel. They got down on their knees, and he prayed, and they consecrated the nation to God as his very first official act as the President of the United States of America. It was King George who said, later after his term of office, he said, if George Washington steps down as president, he is the greatest man I have ever known. And for over 230 years in the United States of America, we have a peaceful surrendering of power without a shot being fired. Never known in any other nation. We have been under the same birth certificate for over 230 years, while every other nation on the face of the earth has had a minimum of over 15 changes of government. We've been under the same birth certificate for over 230 years. Because we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Man doesn't give rights, God does. And if you don't know God, you don't know your rights, because if you don't know God, you don't know truth. You must know this. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman who need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. But we've become inebriated. We have become paralyzed by the idiot box in the corner of our living room. You know, the window into hell in the corner of your living room? It's called a TV, if you're wondering. Oh, what's he talking about? And we sit there, and we just feed on what they give us. Open it up and read it. And so, I want to conclude. Some of you are like, yes. I want to conclude with this. Turn with me, if you would, to Isaiah chapter 9. I said I was going to talk about figs. Isaiah chapter 9. I had been a senior pastor a few short months when September 11, 2001 occurred. I remember seeing the World Trade Centers, and I even watched live as the next plane went into the other tower. My brother-in-law was a pilot, and I was worried. Phone calls being made across the country, hearing of a plane going down in a field in Pennsylvania, watching the Pentagon in flames. I remember the anger and the frustration. My godfather is 98 years young. He's the highest ranking living survivor of the attack on Pearl Harbor. He was on the USS Cassin. He still has a driver's license. Rear Admiral Robert B. Early. I said, Uncle Bob, can you tell me the significance about Pearl Harbor, what it did for the United States of America? He said, on December 7th, 1941, when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, he said, the United States of America had the 22nd largest army in the world. We were behind Romania in a standing army. He said they sank pretty much our entire Pacific fleet with the exception of a few carriers. He said in the following day on December 8th, he said they were lined up around the blocks in every major metropolis in the United States of America and even all of the rural areas around America signing up. And they said Japan awakened a sleeping giant. Within 4 years, we rose our fleet from the bottom of Pearl Harbor, refitted it, took on a two-fronted war between two fascist powers, brought them to their knees, floated that fleet into Tokyo Harbor for the surrender, turned both of those nations around, only asked for enough property to bury our dead. We weren't occupiers, we were liberators, and we left them with a better government than they started with, and we came back. That was the greatest generation in the United States of America. 3,000 people died and around that, and less than 3,000 people. I can't remember the exact numbers in Pearl Harbor. And it ignited a nation to fight for truth. On September 11, 2001, I was a young pastor, and I remember I knew I had the gift of preaching a church down to a manageable size, and I was just struggling because we started with like 50 people, and we were about 70. But I remember after September 11th, the church was packed, and I'm like, my preaching's pretty solid. No, people were scared to death. People were scared to death, and I'm thinking maybe we should go to two services because the chapel's full. And the people were weeping and wanting answers. But you know what happened is after about 4 or 5 months, I thought it was my preaching, but then I talked to the other pastors. They all experienced the same thing. People just went back to their trinkets and baubles and their materialism, and they just figured, well, we'll get through this. Nobody lined up around the block. We had a little nationalism, some fervor, but we didn't really know who the enemy was. I mean, militant Islam. I mean, they're fundamentalists, and then we have fundamentalist Christians, and who's the enemy? We just kind of gave up the fight. Years have passed. Now we're 11 years into this. September 11th came. One fireman came to me and said, you know, Rob, we put the flags at half-mast on September 11th. Do you know that somebody came into our fire station, not just one, but a couple of people came into our fire station saying, why are the flags at half-mast? Because 3,000 people over that died. Hello, McFly. And now we're in a two-fronted war, and we're snatching defeat out of the jaws of victory, if there ever was a victory. We're watching our soldiers die. We don't even want to talk about it anymore. My nephew is a Navy SEAL. They've lost a horrible amount. We find ourselves in this predicament. You know what happened on September 12th, 2001? Tom Daschle, who was the Senate Majority Leader, and it's an irrelevant Republican Democrat because Rudy Giuliani, who was Republican, did the exact same thing. But he stepped in front of a joint session of the House, and he quoted. He gave a really comforting speech, and he quoted out of Isaiah chapter 9, and it was really impressive. And here's what he quoted. He said, "We can take comfort and solace from these words." And Isaiah 9:10 says, "The bricks have fallen down, but we will rebuild with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will replace them with cedars." And really what he was saying is, you know what? The World Trade Centers have come down, but we'll rebuild with stronger stones. We'll show these enemies that we can do it right. And they want to knock down the sycamore trees, we'll rebuild with the cedars of Lebanon. America will rise from the ashes. We will be the phoenix. You will see. He couldn't have quoted a more awful verse. Do you realize what he did? And what Rudolph Giuliani did? They brought judgment. Look at it in context. That's how you discern truth. Context. Look at verse 8. "The Lord sent word against Jacob, and it has fallen on Israel. And all the people will know, Ephraim and the inhabitants of Samaria, who say in pride and arrogance of heart, God is judging them," and in Isaiah, "because they have abandoned the Lord and run for the idols of materialism. They have destroyed their children, their babies, on the hands of the molten hands of Molech to seek financial freedom. They have burned their children alive. They have done human sacrifices. And God is judging the nation." And he writes in Isaiah chapter 9, he says this to the nation because of them abandoning God. And you know what the people's response in the judgment from God? You know what their response is? In pride and arrogance of heart, they look at God and say, "You know what? Go ahead and knock down the bricks. We'll rebuild with hewn stones. Knock down the sycamores." Another translation is figs, because it's a variation if you're an arborist. "And we'll rebuild with cedars. Get lost, God. We don't need you. We never have." In the 1950s, we remove you from the public schools. Prayer is no longer permitted. I'll tell you what, we'll go and arrest a guy for doing a video on Islam, but you go ahead and take the Virgin Mary, cover an excrement, and put pornographic pictures around her, and we'll call it art. And we'll do our foreign policy based on fear. Forget the First and Second Amendment. Forget it all. Just, it's all fear. We want to appease anyone. Because when you stand for everything, you stand for nothing, and you have no foundation, and it's crumbling. You don't know who the enemy is because no one's wrong. Because it's all subjective. We don't know how to stand against anyone. We talk about the American spirit. What is the American spirit? It happened on April 30th, 1789. American spirit is a love for God. First, second, third great awakening. And the ground of a nation's consecration will become the ground of its judgment. When Tom Daschle said, go ahead and knock down the bricks, we'll rebuild with hewn stones. Take down the sycamore, slash figs, and we'll rebuild with cedars. That's an awful thing to have said. He says, therefore the Lord shall set up the adversaries of Rezin against him and spur his enemies on. You just open up a can of Islam. Now you guys are saying, oh, I don't buy it. Well, let's just think about this. April 30th, 1789, this is what I'll close with, April 30th, 1789, George Washington gives his first inaugural address, consecrates the nation to God, walks a few short blocks to St. Paul's Chapel with the vice president, both chambers, and the judges, and everyone in tow. They get down on their knees, they consecrate the nation to God, and they pray. St. Paul's Chapel, lovely little chapel. It had a field in the back where the parson would keep his cattle, and they owned property in the back, and as the city grew up, they sold portions of the property. And you say, well, you know, Washington, D.C. No, it wasn't Washington, D.C. That hadn't been built yet. Lafon had not built Washington, D.C. or designed it yet. It was New York City. And the few short blocks to St. Paul's Chapel is what they call the Old Stone Church. It was the only building to have survived the collapse of the World Trade Centers. And you know where the World Trade Centers were built? On the property that belonged to the parson, right there. And you know what protected the old stone church from being destroyed? An enormous sycamore tree, slash fig. Protected the whole church. It was the only one that survived. This church endured all of the blast, debris everywhere, and everyone gathered at the church. They have a monument to that tree. It's the roots upside down, painted blood red. And then they planted in its place a freedom tree. Cedar. So you know, that's just coincidence. I'll tell you what. God doesn't want to bring judgment on the United States of America. He takes no delight in the death of the wicked. None. But he will only strive with man so long. You can't abort 70 million babies in the United States of America, remove God from every public edifice, remove him from children praying and seeking him in the public schools, remove the foundational truths of who he is, and the education from the New England Primer and everything we've done to make this nation what it is, and then cry out to God, God bless America. It's not going to happen. I'll tell you what we need to change the song to, America bless God. We need to repent. And God is patient. And he is judging us not to destroy us. He's judging us to wake us up. We are $16, maybe $17 trillion in debt. We're in a free fall. We're indebted to China. How did this happen? We walked away from the foundation. I don't care if you're a Republican or a Democrat or an independent. I happen to be a Christocrat. I know this, though, from this end of the room to this end of the room and from the front to the back, every one of us needs to get right with God. It's coming. I pray God has mercy on America. That's the only thing I can ask, Lord. Don't give us what we deserve. God, have mercy on us. But J. Edwin Orr, the foremost historian of revival, said, every revival begins with repentance. Folks, we've walked away from the truth. We've abandoned the Word of God. There's no foundation upon which to stand. The Bible says, ascribe it to your children. Put it on the doorposts of your home. Pour it into their lives. If this is the only time of the week you're cracking the Bible, is when the pastor's preaching, you're starving. It says in Job to hunger for God's word more than your physical food. And if you're opening the Bible on Sunday, you're starving. And you wonder why your faith is dwindling. The Bible says faith comes from hearing, hearing from the Word of God. That's why. Well, it's boring. So what? So is school. But what do you want to be, a vegetable? Do the hard thing. Open the Word and rightly divide it. You have generations behind you looking to you. Leave the place better than you found it. It's not about your comfort. It's about His glory. Let's get busy. Let's get back to the Word. If we seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, all these things will be added unto Him. 2 Chronicles 7 says, if my people, those are Christians, who are called by my name, will humble themselves, I will forgive their sins. It says, will humble themselves and pray, I will forgive their sins and heal their land. I'll tell you the quickest way to dwindle a church. I know how to do it. I'm really good at it. Call for a prayer meeting. It's like, for our church, it's the most important service of the week. God have mercy on us. We cry out and intercede and ask God to bless us. Let's get back to the Word. This is serious. The election's important. But standing among this truth and asking God for mercy, please, God, don't give us what we deserve. Have mercy on us. Hold back your hand of judgment. God, I repent. I want to live my life for you. Help me, God. Help me pour it into the lives of my children, my family, and everyone else. In Jesus' name. Amen? I'm finished. That wasn't funny, was it? That was heavy. We're going to have a time of contemplative worship. And while we're worshiping and the worship team's up here, the prayer team's going to come up. I'm going to ask you to do something. Would you come up and consecrate yourself to God? If you've been struggling in your time in the Word and you've been struggling and pouring these truths into the lives of your children, if you've been running for the baubles and trinkets of life, reestablish and redirect how you're going to live. Come forward and consecrate it as George Washington did with all the members of the government. Today is a day of salvation. Today is a day where we ask God to have mercy on us. Let repentance be the cry of our heart. Take this time to pray. I know it's hot. So what? God wants to do a work in our lives, and it's going to begin right here in Kumulani Chapel. So we'll worship and just come up and just let the Lord have your heart and pray it in. Let's invite the worship team up. I'm going to pray. Lord, thank you for your word. And Lord, I'm rejoicing that you withheld judgment when Jonah went to Nineveh and the people cried out and asked for mercy. You were merciful. God, it's not over. But you send these things so that we wake up. And God, I pray that you'd awaken the sleeping giant of our faith. That we would no longer be so enamored with the temporal, but we would stand upon the eternal, and that we would have that foundation that would bless generations to come. Lord, rearrange our priorities. Do a work now, Holy Spirit, as we worship, that you would stir our hearts to consecrate and pray this in for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.